Macmillan Audio presents The Art of Clear Thinking, written and read by Hasard Lee. This book is dedicated to the warriors of the year who have sacrificed their lives for their country and the pursuit of excellence. Nickel on the grass. Introduction. As a fighter pilot, one of the things you get used to is always being seconds away from a fiery death. You're balancing on a razor's edge of performance where the success of each flight hinges on the accumulation of thousands of correct decisions. It only takes one wrong move for a flight to end in catastrophe, which, unfortunately, has happened often throughout our history.
To give you a sense of the speed at which these aircraft can fly, let me share a story from my time flying an F-16. I was stationed in Korea, and there was a jet coming out of maintenance. The engine had been swapped out, and they needed a pilot to ensure it was airworthy. It was a clean jet. None of the typical missiles, bombs, targeting pod, or external fuel tanks were loaded. In effect, it was a stripped-down hot rod capable of its theoretical maximum speed. When we fly, we usually go out as a formation to work on tactics. Every drop of fuel is used to prepare for combat. This mission, however, called for me to launch by myself and test the engine at multiple altitudes and power settings, with the final check being a maximum speed run, where I was to push the aircraft to its limit. After I took off, I entered the designated airspace over the ocean and quickly ran through the various engine checks. Topped off, I could only carry 7,000 pounds of fuel, which is never enough with the giant engine behind me burning tens of thousands of pounds of fuel per hour. If you look at an F-16 from the side, you can see that it's all engine. The structure is built around it, with the pilot sitting atop it at the front. After 15 minutes, I had finished all the checks except the last one, the max speed run. I was at 25,000 feet when I pushed the throttle forward until it hit the stop. This was full power from the turbofan. Fighter aircraft, though, have an additional power source called afterburner. To enable it, I rotated the throttle outward, allowing me to push it along a separate track. This activated all the boost pumps in the fuel system, which began pulling fuel at a rate that could empty a swimming pool in minutes. This fuel, however, wasn't fed into the engine, but rather, like a flamethrower, injected directly into my exhaust and ignited, creating a 30-foot flame out the back of my aircraft. I could feel the surge and thrust as it pinned me to the back of my seat. I quickly accelerated past Mach 1, the speed of sound that Chuck Yeager famously broke in his Bell X-1. I then began a climb, and within seconds, 35,000 feet went by as I continued to accelerate. Soon I was at 45,000 feet, and I began to shallow my climb to arrive at the 50,000-foot service ceiling. This was as high as I could go, not because the jet couldn't go higher, but because if the cockpit depressurized, I would black out within seconds. Looking out of the canopy at 50,000 feet, the sky was now noticeably darker. I was above most of the atmosphere, and I could see the deep shade of indigo above me slowly transition into the ice blue horizon. The curvature of the Earth was also clearly visible as it bowed across my field of view. To my right, I could see the entire Korean peninsula, green with a thin layer of haze over it. To my left, a few clouds over the yellow sea separated me from mainland China. As I maintained my altitude, the jet continued to accelerate. I was now at Mach 1.4, over 1,000 miles per hour. I only had a few minutes of fuel left, so to increase my acceleration, I pushed the stick forward and started a dive. Through my heads-up display, I could see Mach 1.5 tick by, backed up by an old analog airspeed gauge in front of me, slowly winding clockwise toward the red never-exceed limit. At Mach 1.6, the jet began shaking. The extreme stress of the air resistance, over 300 times what a car experiences at highway speeds, began causing the aluminum alloy wings to flutter, sending vibrations throughout the plane. They were rapidly increasing at a rate that wasn't sustainable to the airframe. Aviation. To make an aircraft fly is a constant struggle against physics. An airliner traveling 600 miles per hour at 30,000 feet is not something that happens naturally. It's not a fail-safe act, meaning the default is to crash, It's up to our ingenuity and decision-making to prevent it from happening. It's a unique environment that's highly unforgiving. Whereas a loss of power in a car typically results in a few hours on the side of a road, a loss of power in the air is often disastrous. Even in business, bet the company decisions are rare, and when encountered, only a fraction of the employees take part in them. Aviation, however, relies on everyone performing at an optimum level just to keep the aircraft flying. It's an unstable system where even a single person forgetting to do their job or doing it improperly can lead to catastrophic results. It was this unforgiving nature, however, that led to a deep focus on decision-making. In the early days of aviation, it seemed as though the obstacles were insurmountable. The crash rate was incredibly high. Accounting for the number of flights today, there would have been a staggering 7,000 airline crashes per year in the late 1920s. This led to a near-obsessive culture around increasing the safety of aviation. Anytime an airplane crashed, an investigation was launched to develop lessons that could be incorporated in future flights. It was this unforgiving nature of aviation that provided the perfect framework for analyzing decisions. The spectacular nature of crashes meant they couldn't be brushed aside. After each crash, a team would be sent to find the root cause, along with the contributing factors to figure out not only how the airplane crashed, but why. It was this culture of acknowledging, understanding, and fixing mistakes that eventually enabled the success of the commercial aviation industry. Today, it represents one of the great human achievements, where, despite nearly 100,000 flights taking off per day, U.S. airlines haven't had a single fatal crash in more than a decade. Air combat adds another layer of complexity to aviation. Not only do pilots have to fly their aircraft safely and contend with weather, terrain, and traffic, among other threats, but they also must compete with the enemy who is trying to shoot them down. The enemy is often highly skilled and adaptable, constantly seeking to exploit vulnerabilities in their opponent's tactics and technology. Each side seeks to deceive and mislead the other in order to interfere with their decision-making ability. In air combat, the threats are continually changing as each side postures to protect their vulnerabilities while also exploiting their adversaries. Decisions are continually tested and countered in the ultimate cat-and-mouse game. This continual evolution has led to a modern battlefield that is as diverse as it is dangerous. Today, the enemy is elusive, hiding in the air, on land, in the sea, in space, and within the cyber realm, looking to specifically target vulnerabilities. There are hypersonic missiles that can travel over a mile per second, stealth aircraft that look smaller than a hummingbird on radar, and sensors that can triangulate targets out to the horizon. Often, the only warning of an impending attack is the deafening shriek of a weapon just seconds before it impacts. The margin of error is incredibly thin. Every aspect of these planes is skewed towards performance, often at the expense of safety. Coupled with near unlimited budgets that can climb into the trillions of dollars, this makes for amazingly capable yet dangerous aircraft to fly. Speed. As I accelerated past 1.6 times the speed of sound, the jet continued shaking from the stress of the airflow across the wings and fuselage. Looking over my shoulder, I could see the F-16's normally rigid wings bending back and forth in the airstream. I had never been this fast before, nor had I experienced high-speed wing flutter. Although the F-16 was designed for this speed, that was for a brand new jet off the line, not the one I was flying, which was 25 years old with thousands of hours on the airframe. After so many flights, each jet had unique characteristics that we tracked and referenced before each flight. Unlike previous generations of fighter pilots who each had their own aircraft assigned to them, pilots today all share jets within a squadron. It's our job to quickly adapt to each jet's unique strengths and weaknesses and merge ourselves into a lethal team. Because a maximum speed run is so rare, there wasn't any data available for this flight. I would have to assess in real time and adapt to the changing conditions. As the buffeting continued to increase, I began by assessing the situation. Looking through my heads-up display, I could see that I was traveling at Mach 1.6. To rule out the chance that it was an indicator error and that I was potentially overspeeding the aircraft, I looked at my standby airspeed gauge and confirmed that my displayed airspeed was correct. From there, I looked at the side slip indicator, which told me if my rudder was aligned into the airstream. When it's not properly set, the plane will skid through the sky, causing a decrease in performance. For a max speed run, everything needed to be perfectly aligned. It was slightly off, so I took my hand from the throttle and reached back to the almost never used trim panel located behind the seat. I kept my eyes forward. Even if I wanted to look at the panel, I wouldn't have been able to see it. The F-16 was designed for a pilot who is 5 feet 10 inches. Being 6 feet 2 inches, wearing a bulky survival vest, and an anti-exposure dry suit to protect myself from the frigid water, I was wedged in the cockpit. I couldn't turn around and see the switches behind me. Instead, I had memorized their location and adjusted them by feel. After centering the rudder, nothing happened. The vibrations were still there and worsening. This was not sustainable to the airframe. An abrupt fatigue failure would be catastrophic at these speeds, causing the plane to instantly break up into thousands of pieces. I was also well outside the ejection envelope. If forced to eject, as soon as the rocket-powered seat blasted me out of the cockpit, nearly every bone in my body would break as it entered the 1,200-mile-per-hour airstream. I remembered back to a conversation I'd had several years prior with an old fighter pilot who went by the call sign Saigon. At the time, I was just learning how to fly the F-16. Saigon, however, was an experienced fighter pilot who had just finished a staff tour at the Pentagon and was now getting requalified on the F-16. We were both students, although his was just a temporary title before he moved on to lead a combat squadron. Saigon was a fighter pilot's fighter pilot, and despite his high rank and status, he spent time with the students doing the grunt work around the squadron. He was a mentor to the students and even to many of the instructor pilots. This lack of hierarchy allowed us to freely have conversations with him, where he would explain the nuances of different tactics and what it took to be a good fighter pilot. One day I walked into the secure vault, which is the tactical nerve center of every fighter squadron, and Saigon was there telling a story about the test program he had been a part of in the F-16. He had learned that in a clean configuration, the F-16 would begin to buffet around Mach 1.6. It was a known area where the aerodynamic forces would compound and amplify the vibrations. He said that it was possible to push through it by counterintuitively going faster. The change in resonance would dampen the flexing and reduce the vibration. It was an interesting story, but one that I didn't think would apply to the tactical flying we did during day-to-day operations. By the time I took off on my maximum speed run, I had long since forgotten Saigon's story. However, I've always been amazed at how long-forgotten information can instantly come back to you when there's a life-or-death decision to make. Nearly every fighter pilot who's had to eject talks about the clarity they had on the complex sequence of memorized steps they needed to take to be rescued, regardless of the time that had passed since their training. As soon as my wings began buffeting, Saigon's story quickly came back to me. While the overall choice I had to make was only whether to slow down or speed up, each course of action led to further decisions. If I elected to slow down, should I pull out of my dive, adding additional stress to the wings? And if so, how hard? Or should I maintain my current dive and just pull the throttle out of afterburner, which would take longer to slow down but minimize the stress? And if I chose to speed up, should I maintain my dive and reduce my control inputs, or should I increase my dive angle to accelerate faster? There were an infinite number of options on how I could execute my decision. I didn't have time to think through each option, so I fell back on the mantra, "There's no problem so bad you can't make it worse." The default decision was to leave the aircraft in its current setting. Based on Saigon's story, the vibrations were most likely tied to my current airspeed. I needed to accelerate through that speed as quickly as possible while not putting unnecessary stress on the aircraft. I elected to slowly push forward on the stick, steepening my dive to increase my acceleration while making sure not to add undue stress to the flight controls. In my heads-up display, I read Mach 1.7 as the vibrations continued to get worse. It now felt like I was driving at highway speeds on an old dirt road. As Mach 1.8 ticked by, it became difficult to read the displays. At this point, my senses were now hyper-aware of everything that was happening around me. I could feel a knot in my stomach. Maybe I'd made the wrong choice. If the plane broke up, nothing of me would be recovered once my body turned into jelly. I quickly pushed the thought away so that I could focus on flying the jet. Then at Mach 1.9, everything smoothed out. It became eerily calm as my airspeed crossed 1,500 miles per hour. When flying a fighter, you typically don't have time to enjoy the view. You're in a tactical bubble where your only thought is on the next decision you have to make. This was one of those rare moments where time seemed to slow down, allowing me to take in the experience. Looking down, I could see cargo ships dragging their long wakes across the ocean as they rapidly fell aft my flight path. I noticed the cockpit felt warm, not like the temperature had been increased, but a radiating heat. The friction of the air was causing the skin of the aircraft to rapidly heat. I took my hand off the throttle and put my Nomex glove about a foot away from the canopy and could feel the heat passing through it, like I was sticking my hand in an open oven. As I entered the thicker atmosphere, my airspeed continued increasing until I was right at the structural limit of the aircraft. Nearly out of fuel and with the max speed run complete, I pulled the throttle out of afterburner. Despite a large amount of thrust still coming from the engine, the drag from the thick air caused the jet to rapidly decelerate, slamming me forward so hard that it locked my shoulder harness straps. Still, it took nearly 50 miles for the aircraft to decelerate below the sound barrier. Decisions. Boiled down, a fighter pilot's job is to make decisions. Thousands of them each flight, often with incomplete information and lives on the line. The decisions start during the mission planning phase, where processes are developed and resources allocated to accomplish an objective. This often involves hundreds of people coming together from disparate backgrounds to align toward one common goal. Then the flight must be executed under the fog and friction of war, where no matter how well a mission is planned, it will change. This means that despite the immense effort that is put into planning a mission, there will always be difficult decisions that need to be made in the air that haven't been anticipated or that don't have textbook answers. Afterward, each decision must then be analyzed to glean any lessons that can be used to improve future decisions. As fighter pilots, we've been on the leading edge of decision-making theory since Air Force Colonel John Boyd developed the OODA, Observe, Orient, Decide, Act, loop, based on his experiences flying missions during the Korean War. In the years since, other fighter pilot greats such as Colonel John Warden and General David Deptula have made significant contributions to the field. It's a constantly evolving field that gives fighter pilots the best mental tools possible to solve the problems they encounter. Though we have talented pilots, the mantra that we better lives.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.